The saying goes, a computer is only as smart as the person using it. And that's because for a computer to perform tasks, the user must know the right commands for that particular operating system. And no two operating systems are the same. Even different versions of Windows or Mac OS are completely different. And don't get me started on all 600 plus different Linux distributions. There is no way I could teach you all the different ways to navigate every single operating system. That would take a gazillion minute long video, and we don't have that long. So instead of trying to teach you how to navigate every single operating system on every single computing device, let's focus on the ways input devices can be used to input commands no matter what operating system your computer uses. By the end of this lesson, you will be able to explain common ways of inputting commands that are effective across different operating systems, and demonstrate how to use commands on your own computer. Let's get into it. Let's start with one of the earliest and most versatile input devices, the keyboard. Once you have enough experience with them, you can use a keyboard to input like 99% of all possible commands. That's because holding any of these highlighted keys on a keyboard changes the input of other keys from text to commands. Even on keyboards made for different operating systems, most of the keys are still the same, and you can use a lot of the same shortcuts to input the same commands. On Windows or Linux, if I hold the Control key and then press C, it copies whatever I've highlighted. Then I can hold Control again and press V, and it pastes that copy wherever my cursor is. Now, if you use an Apple device, their keyboards have essentially the same shortcut, but that first button is called Command instead of Control. Or if you wanted to switch quickly between open programs, you could hold Alt, then press Tab on Windows or Linux, or Option and Tab on an Apple keyboard. There are hundreds, if not thousands, of different commands like this, and most of them you'll have to learn over time as you use your computer. To start with, try out some of the commands listed in the PDF for this lesson. Next up is the mouse. Most people already know you can move your cursor by moving a mouse, but it can do way more than that. Most mice have two buttons. With the first button, you can click to select things, known as a left click. You can also double click this button to perform special actions like opening a program. Or if you hold the button while moving the mouse, you can highlight or drag objects on the screen. When you click the other button, which is called right clicking, you get a small context menu that changes depending on what the cursor was pointing at. Some mice have a wheel or motion sensor in the middle. As you move your finger over it, whatever is on your screen will scroll down or up. Depending on your computer, you can also use the scroll wheel while holding down a specific button on your keyboard to instead zoom in and out. For those who are unable to use a hand mouse, a foot mouse is a possible accommodation to input all the same commands by moving your feet around and pressing different buttons. If you're watching this on a smartphone or tablet, you probably don't have a mouse or keyboard anywhere near you. Instead, handheld computers use a touchscreen for, well, pretty much everything. If you need to select something, you touch it. If you need to type, you tap the text box, and a virtual keyboard automatically pops up. But even touchscreens have hidden commands. Like if you take two fingers, touch them to the screen, then pull your fingers away from each other, a motion we call pinching out,
it allows you to zoom in.
You can also do the opposite, pinch in to zoom back out. And remember how you can right-click on a mouse to bring up that context menu? You can get the same thing on most touchscreen devices by holding or long pressing your finger or stylus on the touchscreen. Most laptops these days have trackpads, which have the ability to enter the commands of both mice and touchscreens. As you move your finger around the trackpad, your on-screen cursor moves just like if you were using a mouse. Some trackpads even have two buttons with the same functions as the left and right buttons on a mouse. But the really cool part of trackpads is how you can use a lot of the same touch motions that you can on a touchscreen. Pinch out on a trackpad, and your screen will zoom in, or pinch in to zoom back out. Swipe two fingers, and you'll see your screen scroll down or up. Next time you have access to both a touchscreen device and a trackpad device, test it out and see how many of the motions on one do the same thing on the other. Don't forget there are a lot more input devices than just the physical ones. If your device has a microphone and a virtual assistant program installed, you can say their name and tell them what you want to do, and they'll do their best to help you. Hey, Mia, can you help me add my dentist appointment to my schedule? It's Tuesday at 1 o'clock. No, 1 o'clock p.m., not 1 o'clock a.m. The downside of virtual assistants is that if your instructions are too vague, they might misunderstand what you wanted and end up doing something you don't expect, like schedule your dentist appointment for the middle of the night. If you have an eye-tracking input device, you can also use your eyes to control your computer's user interface. Most eye trackers allow you to move the on-screen cursor simply by looking where you want it to be, and then you can stare or wink at that spot in order to select or click. And that's basically it. Eye trackers are not precise enough yet to reliably recognize any other eye movements, like an eye roll or a quick glance. Luckily, programs have been created to get around this issue. By staring at the kind of action you'd like to do, then staring at the place you want to do it to, you can double-click or right-click whatever you're staring at. The benefit of computers being so widely used these days is that people expect every computer to be operated using similar inputs, so programmers try to make us happy. But we also like being able to customize the controls to our own liking. For that reason, our next lesson will be all about how you can use the settings and accessibility options on your computer to truly personalize the way you use it. Until then, remember, your brain is the smartest computer you'll ever have, so keep it charged and never stop updating it. See you next time!